Okay. I'll you want me to tell this?
Yeah, before you start.
Okay.
That if anybody wants to be recording, they can.
Okay.
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 Thank you, and you can introduce yourself.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Okay. You can I start now?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. All right. So Oh, before I start, I'd like to let you know that this lecture is live streamed on YouTube, so you're more than welcome to share it for the people who haven't been able to make it today. I'd like to show my deepest gratitude to His Highness and then also the HIPAA for bringing me here and having this opportunity to speak about photography in my planet. I love the title, isn't it? Because, you know, I'm living in the same planet as you are, but, you know, it's so different, I assume. But I hope you enjoy the history of Japanese photography and its diversity. And then I have to apologize that, you know, my English is not my first language, so I'll try my best to be fluent as possible, but I may kind of stumble a little bit there and here. So this is the title, and then before I start, you know, I'd like to introduce myself. My name is Hiro Hayami. I'm the founder of T3 Photo Festival Tokyo, and I'm the director of Tokyo Institute of Photography, and then also I'm the former editor-in-chief of Fat Photo Magazine. And this is the cover of the Fat Photo Magazine that I was actually editing. The left photograph was the first issue that I actually was, you know, when I became assigned as a chief editor, and then the right one is the last issue. I think it is interesting to point out those two cover photographers are both female that we found on Flickr at the time. You know, there was no Instagram. But now Natsumi Hayashi, she's the photographer on the left, and Izumi Miyazaki is the one on the right. They are both selfie, okay? And on one, they are both a pretty well-known photographer now. Natsumi actually has shown her work at Parifoto. Herself is going very well. The other, Izumi Miyazaki, has recently become the main visual of Kyotography, which is the photo festival in Kyoto. Okay, so this is the festival that I do in Tokyo. Well, this is from the first edition, so a couple years ago. It's already 4 years ago, so it's quite old. But this is what I do as a festival director. There is a portfolio view. Just little bit things that I do portfolio view for like New York Times portfolio view, Latin American Photography Forum, competition judge. We did HIPAA, obviously, but I recently did one in KLPA, which is one in Malaysia, and lens culture quite often. Also, I'm a lecturer, and then I done speech in photography of Bogota, which is in Colombia, and then also Wonder Photo Day, which is a photo festival in Taipei. But again, this is my first time actually giving a lecture all in English, so I'm actually quite nervous. So hopefully you guys are very nice, okay? So what is Japanese photography? And this is a good question, because Japanese photography, as far as I understand, is known by a few names of photographer, such as Rinko Kawauchi or Hiroshi Sugimoto, and obviously Daido Moriyama. And in recent years, as the rise of photo book as a form of art, attention towards Japanese photo books are heightened, and I think that's how a lot of people notice about Japanese photography. Okay. So today I'm going to do something crazy because I'm going to talk about history of Japanese photography, which is 170 years in 90 minutes. And that's 2 years in 1 minute. That's crazy, yeah? So you don't blame me for doing it very fast. I'm going to put a lot of information. And there are three keywords that I brought it up for this lecture or talk. One is photography as shashin. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And Tohoku and March 11th, 2011. This is obviously about the earthquake and the tsunami. And what's next? So we'll start with photography as shashin. Okay. So just a brief idea. Arrival of photography to Japan, it first came in 1848, the daguerreotype, when Japan was still closing the country. So there is no way we can communicate with outside people. This is truly the different planet, yeah? But we had actually a trade with Dutch. There is only the country that we could actually trade. So we had the daguerreotype came into Japan in 1848, but it never spread it out. You know, it was never popular. But in 1854, when opening of Japan, which is known as the Black Ship, Matthew Perry from the United States came to Japan and demanded to open the country. We did. And in 1857, collodion process became super popular. And now I'd like to talk a little bit about our language, because each language has different words, and sometimes even you're saying something, there's no translation correctly for one language to another. And this is what we called photography when photography first came to Japan. And as you may know, Japanese is a logogram. So we use a Chinese character called kanji that came from China. And each letter has a meaning. So this means like this. This is shashin kyo, means to copy the truth as a mirror. So that's the literal translation of photography at the time. That kind of is funny, huh? And photography was very, very popular. I mean, this is a ukiyo-e drawn by Kunichika Toyohara. And you can see a photography there. And then look at this. This photography studio, so popular, it's on the left side, right there. Okay, so I'm just showing you how popular it became. And this is also interesting ukiyo-e about how was the new technology taking over the old technology? And here also you see ukiyo-e and photography fighting like that. So ukiyo-e was taken over by photography, like I suppose the paintings and drawing in the Western culture was taken over by photography. Now, just speaking a little bit more about ukiyo-e. This is a famous image by Hokusai. It's very photographic moment, isn't it? It was done in 1850s, so it was before photography. But this is a very photographic moment. The wind blows and then the paper just flies. This is like the moment that you want to capture with photograph, right? And Hokusai was able to do that somehow, even though without the photographic technology. This is very also a very famous ukiyo-e by Hokusai. But if you want to try to capture something like this with photography, you need 1/8000th second to capture it. So somehow Hokusai had this imagination to create this ukiyo-e. This is another ukiyo-e, and I'm showing this because ukiyo-e was very, very popular to kind of show a special moment in our everyday life. This is when fireworks, we love fireworks, by the way, in Japan, with people on the boat and just watching the fireworks. And interestingly, this is a photograph of Japan shot by Adolfo Fasari. He's an Italian photographer, and he came in and take photograph of this. And it's just like ukiyo-e, right? And then it's colored. And we call it Yokohama Shashin. I think, as far as I'm understanding, people love the ukiyo-e, and I think a lot of people is fascinated about the Japanese culture. But I'm just kind of imagining back in time, people came and look at the, you know, the Tokyo, and they were like, wow, it's really like ukiyo-e. So they wanted to take something as a memory, you know, and take photograph, and they bought it, and was colored like ukiyo-e. So this was the very beginning of photography. Now we just call it two copy truth, shashin. It's interesting, you know, it's never drawing with the light. So the reason that I'm explaining why we call it shashin is so important is because we take, well, not today, obviously, but at the time, a lot of people believe what is photographed is the truth. You know, people believe if you see something photographed, people believe that it's actually happened. But of course, it's not necessarily true. I mean, it did happen, but it's only one way to look at it. And photography was very huge, and then it was widely used, especially during the wartime. And this was a huge problem because a lot of people wanted to use photography as a propaganda to tell, you know, what's happening and how great Japan was. And during the wartime, between 1934 and 1945, Nippon Kobo, which is the first photo agency and publisher of Nippon Magazine, they published a lot of stuff that needs to be, well, told to foreign countries. And there is another graphic magazine called Front. This was also published in 1945. And I'm mentioning this because Japan has learned a lot of lessons from by the defeat of the war. A lot of photographers at the time realized that photography can lie. So like photographer, I'll talk about it later, but a lot of photographers had to change the way they used the photography after the war. But during the wartime, there's a lot of changes. Obviously, the scarce of resources, there is a lot of photography magazine before, but during the war or by the end of the war, there was only two magazines. And it is very important to mention that our culture, or in Japanese photography magazine had a very, very strong presence. Like a lot of competition happened in photography magazines, and it still happens today. So a lot of amateur photographers basically learned photography through entering the competition in Japanese magazine, and all the professional photographer actually gives you a critique on the magazine, and people read it and to become better. And one of the leading photographer at the time was Ken Domon, and he basically is the one who criticized about the Front and the Nippon magazine that I show you, as these foreign propaganda are cultural fictionalism, and meaning pretending to be something who we are not, and emphasizing Japan's military forces to excess. So it's very important to know that there is a time that a lot of Japanese photographers worked for these propaganda, but there are some photographers who refuse to work for the propaganda. Now, this was a turning point. This is a picture or image called The Sun, August 15th, 1945, shot by Hiroshi Hamaya. And this reminds me especially of something. It is the reverse of Japanese national flag. So when the war ended, everything had changed. You know, we were taught we had a militarist education, but all of a sudden it became like democracy. So everything you were told before had to be like turned over 180 degrees. So this was a big change for Japanese people. They were shocked. Like they were told this was the truth, this was something you have to follow, but you know, at the end of the war, people were told that, okay, sorry, that was not the truth. You know, we have to change the way we live. So that's pretty messed up, yeah? And so what happened in the photography is called era of absolute honesty, called Zettai Hienshutsu. That's how you pronounce it. Zettai Hienshutsu means era of absolute honesty, or in pursuit of realism. So photographer realized that photography can lie. So all these photographers decided that they should never lie through photography. So that's the era of honesty. So Ken Domon was the leader who, you know, you saw the picture of the Buddha of the hand. He was the leader on this movement, and his realism was about how he faced the society, the survivor of Hiroshima, and as we see here, one of the example. And again, he was one of the judges of monthly competition in Japanese magazine, so he was the one who was advocating this idea of realism, you know. You have to be honest, you have to tell the truth. And also, another change came as we lost the war and we started having a lot of influence from overseas. And one was from Cartier-Bresson, and photographer Ihei Kimura, he was the founder of the Front magazine. They decided he was just shocked by how Bresson used his Leica in, you know, capturing the moment or decisive moment in perfect composition, and then that's how he influenced. So there is a movement about realism, and then also the it's kind of the same movement, but the Kim Ihei was influenced on Bresson's work. Again, but while there is a movement called realism, there are some other photographers who didn't want to follow the movement. So this is Shoji Ueda, and I don't know, maybe some of you might have seen this work, because this work has been recently published a couple of years ago by Charles Commune, who's a French publisher. Shoji Ueda was a local photographer living in Tottori, and Tottori is the place, only place in Japan there is a desert, okay? And so, and he was born, lived, and died in Tottori. He never got out of the prefecture. So he used his family as his subject. He used, obviously this is staged, so in that sense it's not a realism, but you know, he used his family as his subject and take this amazing, still fresh, stylized composition photograph. It's amazing. I think a lot of people still like these images even today. Okay, now as we enter the 1960s, we'll be talking about era of subjective photography, and especially the Vivo. It's a legendary photo agency that you should definitely know when you're speaking about Japanese photography. Realism photography movement was gradually diminishing by the end of the 1950s. Due to several reasons. One is that, well, many photographers ended up shooting similar subject on similar themes, and most of the time subject was socially disadvantaged people or outsiders. So you were starting seeing cliches all the time. So people are like, we've seen that already, you know? And for another, photography magazine that the Domon was doing the judge went out of publishing, you know, went out of print, because people were like, why do we always have to see about the social problem all the time? So people didn't buy the magazine and they went out. So that was the reason it was going down. But now, in counter to the realism movement, there is this subject photography that came, and I think it's best exemplified by the group Vivo, which consisted of six photographers: Eiko Hosoe, Tomatsu Shome, Iko Narahara, Kikuji Kawada, Akira Tanno, Akira Sato. I'm sure you will not be able to remember, but I'll write it down later so you don't have to remember now. This generation of photographer received, like I said, militaristic education as they had grown up, but after the war, democracy was being taught. So that meant two things. One is the freedom of expression. They could do whatever they wanted to do, but at the same time, there was a distrust of the government, distrust of the Bob generation embedded in their mind all the time. So you kind of have to know how they were, you know, at the time. So this is, let's talk about the work of Shome Tomatsu. And this is a Japanese master who has great influence on the photographer who came after him. And this photograph is called, well, this is from the series called Chewing Gum and Chocolate. And in 1956, Tomatsu became an independent photographer, and his series Chewing Gum and Chocolate has captured the presence of America in Japan. And he used this quote, suddenly given a strange reality which I call occupation. This is another example of Shomei Tomatsu's photograph. It's completely different from what we have seen before about the realism movement. This looks like a like burnt skin or something torn, or maybe a flesh of human, but it's not. It's actually a beer bottle after the atomic bomb explosion. Amongst many cities Tomatsu has created, Nagasaki 1102, which is the time, deserves a lot of attention. This is the image called beer bottle after the atomic bomb explosion. Well, you know, a quick glance at this image leaves the viewer with a startling impression, right? And this is something that was completely different from the past photograph that he had, the previous photographers made. I'll show you some of the other works that Tomatsu made. This is also from the series, Nagasaki. In 1960, Tomatsu was offered offered the assignment of documenting after effects of the atomic bomb. He knew little about Nagasaki, and like many Japanese, had chosen not to confront the trauma of the bombing. But upon exploring the city, he was shocked by the depths of the scars and the lingering effect on the survivors. The initial assignment resulted in Hiroshima Nagasaki document 1961, a collaboration with Ken Domo, which is the photographer we already know, and a lifelong interest in the city. And further visit in the early 1960s resulted in the 1966 publication 1102 Nagasaki, and arguably one of the most significant books of modern Japanese photography. As with so much of Tomatsu's work, a major theme of 1102 Nagasaki is the collision of East and West and the cultural and moral repercussion that followed. So Tomatsu is taking a photograph of, you know, details, you know, all the things that impacted, well, a lot of, well, I guess the scars, you can say, and it was completely different the way photographed before. And also another photographer, Kikuji Kawada, is also from this era, and then this is also something completely different. This is more subjective, you know, more feeling they had about the time. So the characteristics of Vivo generation is the complex and tough experience of the war, childhood memory of desolated ruin after the air raid, and the forced denial of the value that by the defeat of war. These memory and experience of war are projected on their works. So you can kind of see, you know, you can kind of feel what are the feeling they had through these photographs. So that's different, you know, it's not about the realism, it's about how the photographer felt or see, you know, saw the world as it was that day. And this series is called The Map. It's a very famous photo book series. You may be able to find it on eBay for a couple thousand US dollars if you want to buy it. But it's definitely worth seeing if you have a chance to take a look. And after the Vivo generation, there comes this Provoke generation, which is more experimental photography. And the influence of Vivo generation leads to the next movement called Provoke, an independent photography magazine founded by a photographer Yutaka Takanashi and Takuma Nakahira. And the magazine subtitle read as Shiso no tameno chouhatsuteki shiryou, and that means provocative documents for the sake of thought, as it says right here. And then on the very beginning of the magazine, there's a manifesto. I think this is very interesting because Provoke generation wanted to capture something that a word cannot describe. So it says, today, when world wars have lost their material base, in other words, their reality, and seem suspended in mid-air, a photographer's eye can capture fragments of reality that cannot be expressed in language as it is. he can submit those images as a document to be considered alongside language and ideology. This is why, brash as it may seem, Provoke has the subtitle Provocative Document for Thought. And this is an image shot by Takuma Nakahira in 1960s. And Provoke argue that the photographer can capture what cannot be expressed in words, presenting photograph as documents for others to read. In Japanese, the visual style of photography in Provoke has been described as are bure boke, which translates as grainy, rough, blurry, out of focus. And this is a photograph shot by Takuma Nakahira from a series called For a Language to Come. As you can see, he pushes his image to the edge of what is recognizable. Nakahira's blurry images are not simple disregard for the convention of photography, but rather a conscious effort to reveal the unconscious. And again, also the Provoke generation is also known by Daido Moriyama. He has recently won the Hasselblad Award 2019, and some of you may have seen this exhibition with William Klein and Daido Moriyama at Tate Modern. This happened a couple of years ago. And Daido Moriyama was assistant of Eiko Hosoe, one of the photographers from Bibo. He became independent in 1965, and for the serious assignment from photography magazine Kamera Mainichi, he shot tourist spots and troops of traveling performers. And his photography style is very much influenced by William Klein, as you may have recognized. The very high contrast and rough black and white. You can see the grain of film if you look at closely enough. But unlike Klein, his intention was never capturing the vibrant or the emotion or atmosphere of those people. What he was doing was liking the style of William Klein and just using it to do what he wants to do. And what he says is that his physiological sense to react to the subject and captures it. This is a series called Photo Theater. And the idea of photography for him, for Daido, is really shashin, you know, to make a copy of a fact. So what he did was similar to like maybe a pop art like Andy Warhol. This is one of the iconic photographs called Stray Dog Misawa. But there is this many photographs of Misawa, and some of them even reversed. Yeah, but he doesn't really care, because to him it's just copying. So this I think shows, you know, unique implication of what photography is for Daido. I'm going to talk about a little bit about our language again. This is called to shoot, like to photograph, you know, as a verb. But in Japanese, we write it like this, to collect shadow. So it's very interesting, you know, how we use word differently. Because, you know, there is a famous book by Junichiro Tanizaki, In Praise of Shadows. You know, we are all about shadows. We're not about the light. We always see what's behind the darkness. And maybe it's a metaphor of what we're seeing, you know, in the World War II, you know, what happened in the dark. And it also reminds me of like Sen no Rikyu, you know, the great master who had the most profound influence of the Channel Yu, the way of tea, disseminate the idea of wabicha. Wabicha is about, you know, you become simple, you know, you don't have to do anything that is flashy. So that's, you know, it's interesting. So there is a subjective photography by Vibo, an experimental photography by Provoke, and photographer after photographer, they influence each other. So what comes after is a personal photography known as shishashin. It's shi, watashi means my, and photograph, basically. And this is one of the photographer known for the shishashin, Araki Nobuyoshi, Nobuyoshi Araki, and his work Sentimental Journey. And the leader of this movement is Nobuyoshi Araki, and who looked enviously at the pro-Bolk movement. The Sentimental Journey, published in 1972, have the feel of like cinema-like story. He says this is a personal document of photographer and his wife's honeymoon trip, but at the same time, it looks kind of very staged, yeah? So the uniqueness of Shishashin is that it is based on the life experience of the photographer mixed with the truth and the false. And another photographer from this era is Masahisa Fukase, and his photograph, Raven, is very, very well known. He also was very egoistic, and he basically, well, some of you have actually seen this retrospective of Fukase in Arles Photo Festival 2 years ago, which also resulted in his retrospective book. I'm not going to elaborate on his work, but he has a project on his family portraits and his ex-wife, Yoko. So he's using his personal experience or personal life as his subject and creating kind of docu-fiction type of story. Now, finally, by 1970, we have female photographer coming up in Japan. Her name is Miyako Ishiuchi. She's also one of the Hasselblad Award winner, I think from 2014, so it's a couple, 5 years ago. She creates works based on her personal memory as well. This is probably her very first series called Yokosuka Story. Is based on her childhood memory in Yokosuka, where the US base is located at. And she absolutely hated it, hated the neighborhood, and have a traumatic memory of the place due to its complex situation, like prostitution was active, and then there is a lot of violence, especially toward women in the area. So in this series, she visits and takes photographs of Yokosuka, projecting her memory and making the series quite an unforgettable one. So when she sees a girl, she basically projects herself to the subject and take photograph. And Miyako Ishiuchi is, again, very important figure as we can consider her works as the objection toward male dominant role of photography or dominant photography in Japan. This is another work by Miyako Ishiuchi. This is called Mother. She takes the photograph of what her deceased mother had left after, you know, and she takes these photographs. So she's always taking a photograph of something very personal and then creating something out of it. Now, after the personal photo shishashin movement, there is a search for the ethnic culture in 1970s. And this is quite interesting because this is shot in Japan, but this has some similarity to maybe, you know, some of the culture here. And I think it is interesting to point out that Japan is far east and then it's island. So a lot of things are imported to Japan and it stops there, you know, because there is a Pacific Ocean and it doesn't go to the United States. So a lot of people come, like people from maybe South Pacific Asia come, maybe people from Africa came, we don't know, and we have all these different culture mixing in Japan. So we consider Japan as something that is very, homogeneous thing, but in reality, if you look close, if you have a closer look, we have different cultures mixed up in our country. So again, I'm going back to the 1970s ethnic culture movement. Is basically photographer decided to look for their origins. And this is a photograph captured by Issei Suda, who has just recently died a week ago. This is a good example of the time. This is a photograph of a traditional matsuri, or the festival, but it stands out in the series. He has captured the otherworldly feeling, the boundary between ordinary and non-ordinary. And then when they pursued, or they became they were searching for the ethnic background, a lot of people went to Tohoku. And Tohoku is a region up in north, right? And it is the place that a lot of Japanese look for inspiration, like Japanese master poet Matsuo Basho, which resulted in his masterpiece called Oku no Hosomichi. The English title is The Narrow Road to the Deep North. And even today, we can still find the thriving culture and shamanism, for example, and a ritual which has been continued more than 1,300 years in Tohoku region. So it's the region that we see something mysterious going on, you know, something spiritual. If you want to find something like that, everybody goes to Tohoku. This is the work by Masatoshi Naito called Grandma Explosion. He photographed the folk religions in Tohoku, such as Osore-san in Aomori, as well as Tono in Iwate. And his focus on the series were old ladies in the community and who protected their ritual and the ceremonies. Naito photographs them with strong flash standing them out in the dark background, and his use of flash and the distortion effect caused by the wide-angle lens successfully captures the shaman who connect our world and other world. And I'd like to end this era by mentioning the work of Eiko Hosoe. This is very well-known series called Kamaitachi. And this work is made in collaboration with Butoh dancer or performing artist Tetsumi Hijikata. And it is shot in Akita Prefecture, which is also Tohoku region, where the dancer was born. And Hijikata, by improvisation, performed folkloric monster in the region called Kamaitachi. And Hosoe photographed the performance. And this series is very important in two senses. One is Kamaitachi was performed as a metaphor of diminishing countryside as Japan was experiencing the rapid economic growth. So these things, ritual, were dying or were thought they were dying at the time. And also the other part is that this is a collaboration of photography and a performance. So this was a little bit of an experimental photography. In 1980s, there was a rise of photography museum. Finally, we started to have a photography museum in 1980s. There had never been the idea of collecting photography until then. We didn't have galleries. All we had was magazines. So idea of original print or vintage print doesn't exist until this time. So it's good to know that, you know, finally by 1980s we decided, oh, photography can be art. But before then, it was not really art form. It was more people used it as the medium to express, but it was not considered as like serious art. So in 1990s and 2000, there was a movement called Gallery Photo. And this generation photographers are found by two major photography competition in Japan, known as One Wall and Canon New Cosmos of Photography. The names of the photographer include Mika Ninagawa, Rika Noguchi, Rinko Kawauchi, Hiromix, and Yurie Nagashima as such. And I think the Hiromix and Mika Ninagawa are the two names who drew the most attention at the time. As you can see, they're both doing the selfies. Hiromix says in her Grand Prix award statement, "The photography is the most radical and instant way to express myself." And this simply exemplifies the close relationship between photography and female at the time and the great potential of self-expression in somewhat oppressed society. And the term girly photo was somewhat used cynically by the female photographers. And it treated the female photographer as girl and not woman. Yet the photographer of this generation consciously used this term to get their presence out. So it's kind of important to know that people didn't like the term girly photo, but they used it in any way because that's how catchy it was. And at last, from this generation photographer, I'd like to mention about Rinko Kawauchi. She's now so popular and very famous all over the world. So you might have seen this work called Illuminance. This was done in 2011, so this is a kind of new work, but she was discovered in 2001 by winning the award and from the Gallery photo era. And Yeah, I mean, this is, I don't know, this is a very beautiful image. This is like a visual poetry to me. You know, it has some feeling of like universal beauty and transcends time and place kind of aesthetic. So I think this appeals to a lot of people, not just Japanese, but it was very special, I think, for Japanese audience to find female photographer who can actually create this type of photograph. Also, I'd like to talk about work by Takashi Honma. It says city and landscape, but it's about cityscapes. Because in 1970, there was a movement of photographers who explored ethnic culture, but the photographers who were born during those period of high economic growth focused on Tokyo in 1990 and 2000. So there is people before who, you know, after the war, they were thinking about where we came from, you know, what is our origin. So they went to Tohoku to discover about our identity. But people who were born during those high economic growth, that was not their origin. Their origin was suburbs. So this is the photograph that he took in 2000. It's called a series called Tokyo Suburbia. And this is very interesting because the suburbs is like almost a product of capitalism. So always often this was, you know, in the center of discussion where all the kinship is lost, you know, those local community is lost, everything looks kind of same, you know, capitalism kind of thing. But this photographer came from this generation, wanted to actually express the suburbs kind of affirmatively. So this is shot with quite light tone, but you know, interestingly, has a certain distance. So what Takashi Honma says is that even since we were born, there is a certain distance with others, and by fact, we are not able to live in a close community. So there is this statement or objection about, you know, we have to have a community kind of thing. And it's very interesting. Some photographer says one thing, you know, the community is important, but at the same time, who are born from these community mention something completely different. So I just kind of wanted to bring this up, not to justify anything, but just to mention that there is always different way to looking at the thing. And 2000... finally, I think, is photography as contemporary art comes. Like, this is the work by Hiroshi Sugimoto. He's probably the most successful Japanese photographer or Japanese artist in the international art market. His series, Diorama, Seascape, and Theater, all shot with large format camera with long exposure, creating a zen-like, quiet atmosphere. His concept of transcending the time and place and capturing the origin of things are highly appreciated by international audiences. And I mean, he was very clever, I have to say, that he studied about Japanese art. He also studied about how Japanese art was taken in by American, mostly because he was based in New York. So he combined those two, he balanced it out and created this series, and it was very, very successful. There is another female artist named Tomoko Sawada. This is interesting. This is very Japanese, yeah? It's called School Days. And now I'm going to talk about Tomoko's work because she's rather an artist who uses photography, you know, than photographer, I would say. You can tell that this is a group shot, and a convention of group shot has a great history in Japan. And this is very typical, school group shot. And a lot of people think, you know, when you look at these photographs, people will think, okay, so Sawada is expressing about homogeneity and conformism in Japanese society. But the truth is actually quite opposite. If you look closely, and if you're at the close observation, you can find all the girls look different. I mean, she creates 10 images like this, so she performed 400 different characters, and each have different look. You know, it's not... So, I mean, if she wanted to talk about the, conformism, this is too obvious. You know, it's not subtle. So she create something that looks, I mean, same in uniform. I mean, even the teacher on the right side is hard. But if you look closer, it's different. And it's so funny because, you know, a lot of people think, oh, wow, the girl on the left looks mean, you know, girl in the middle seems a very nice person. So we kind of judge people by how they look. But, you know, she questions what is, you know, appearance and what's in herself. And I think she uses, you know, the sense of humor to create this photograph. I think partly because she's from Osaka, which is where the comedy is very popular in her region. This is also interesting work done by a Japanese artist, Yasumasa Morimura. He basically turned himself into a historical art portrait. This is funny and I mean interesting by looking at, but you know I think about, you know, what's his story behind this, you know, why did he do this, you know, why did he want to become a Van Gogh or somebody else, and I assume this is not what he said, but I assume that, you know, I have two kids and I tell my son and daughter when they're in fight, say, you know, try to be, you know, other people's shoes, you know, in shoes. So if you want to try to understand somebody, probably the best way to become or turn yourself into Van Gogh or something. He wanted to understand about the art, so he turned himself into those art historical portraits. That's my assumption. And it's interesting because the work is very new. This is done in 2000, but the left one is done in 1985. But till 1985 till 2000, he has only performed Western figures. And I think it's because the art history is Western art history in our country. Or maybe, I don't know, maybe in the world as well. So he became Van Gogh and then became all the other famous portraits. He became even a Hollywood stars and everything. But by 2000, I think it was 10 or 12, he finally found himself into Japanese. And as I think interesting, you know, we are always trying to find our identity, you know, who are we, you know, in pursuit of ethnic culture to turning himself to somebody else. You know, it's just like always in search of who we are. Some topics that I'd like to mention very quickly. This is a photographer named Mao Ishikawa. She's very, she's 80 years old female woman photographer based in Okinawa. And this is a series called Great Ryukyu Photo Scroll. And this is a stage photograph, obviously, of the history of Okinawa and how the Japanese society or the Japanese government or US military has been treating Okinawa. So it's very political piece about Okinawa. And then, you know, we consider Okinawa as a place for resort. So we go on the beach and, you know, enjoy the sunset, but where, you know, they're having a lot of problem, like Yokosuka, where the US base was located at. And this is also interesting to mention about Aya Fujioka's recent work called Here Goes River. And this is, you know, about, as you can see, Hiroshima after the war, in 73 years later after the war. So we still talk about, you know, what is Hiroshima to us, you know, what is the peace to us, you know, it's everyday life of Hiroshima as you see, 73 years later from the atomic bomb. But, you know, you can, even the funny image, you know, on the left hand, left corner, there is, you can see the famous Hiroshima image. Yeah. So I just kind of did very briefly about Japanese history, and then I can't believe it only took me an hour to do this. But I'm going to talk a little bit more serious from here about what my experience. This was very brief history about Japanese photography, but this is more about myself and then how I take photography from here. Okay, so March 11th in 2011, there is a Tohoku earthquake, the big magnitude of 8.8. And on the day of March 11th, I was actually flying from Tokyo to to other places in Japan. So when the earthquake hit the land, I was not feeling it. I was on the airplane. When I landed, I got a text message from my sister saying, "Are you okay?" And I was not sure what she meant because, you know, I was on the business trip, and what do you mean by "Are you okay?" So I'm like, "I'm okay," and I tried to send the text back, but it failed. So the reception didn't go on. So I was like, "What's happening?" Now I get off the airplane and I walk in the lobby of the airport, and I see these TVs and people are crowded around the TV and looking something. I was like, "What is that?" So I go walk toward there, and I still remember exactly the moment where my in-laws' house or area where my in-laws live has been just smashed by tsunami. So that was my experience of the earthquake. So I was very much shocked with what happened, and it just really made me think about a lot of things. At the time I was working for this gallery in 2011. So I was a gallery director, and I was, you know, when the earthquake happened, I realized there is not much thing I could do using my skill for business. You know, my photography skill, or, you know, I mean, editing skill or curating skill. There's nothing I could do about it. What I could do, obviously, is send the money to my in-laws, or send clothes, or send food. But that's it. So I started feeling, oh my God, the photography is so, I mean, in my case, powerless. Like, I could not really do anything. If I was a journalist, maybe I could go up there and take photographs of what was happening and tell people what's going on. But, I mean, I couldn't do any of that. So it made me really think about what I should do, what I should be doing in my career in photography business, so to speak. And I'm going to show a little bit of work done by a Japanese artist after the March 11th. Those works are mostly related of done by a photographer who was actually living or have close relationship to the region. This is work by Lie Koshiga, and she was working in Tohoku region at the time too. And then, as you can see, this is very strong image. You know, this is something almost like, to me, if you look at the book, you know, it's almost like a requiem for the dead. Like it's the other side of the world, and then our world is kind of interconnected in the photographic world. So this is very interesting piece by Lie Koshiga called Rasen Kaigan. This is Mayumi Suzuki. She's a good friend of mine called Restoration Will. She, I don't know, maybe you have seen her book. She recently won some award, international award, for España last year, something like that. What it is that her family, she was born in Onagawa in Tohoku Prefecture, and she, her parents had a photography studio, and basically her parents were killed or died in tsunami. And after the March 11th, she went back to her parents, where it used to be their house and studio. She finds the camera and lens. I mean, her parents' body was lost, so she hasn't still yet found her parents yet. But she found this broken lens of large format camera her father used to take photographs with. So I think it took her almost 3 years doing, takes time, yeah? You know, to just consume what happened and understand what you have to do with it. But finally she decided that she wanted to take a photograph with the lens, and then she tried to restore the memory back with the photograph. So the title of the work is called Restoration Will. So and also there is another work by Naoya Hatakeyama, and also this Lost and Found project. And then I think what is so interesting about photography is that, you know, when, I mean, you look at this picture and you see debris. And we say debris so easily, but for those people who died or who lost their friends, it's not just the debris, it's a part of their life, you know. And, you know, as much as photography can hold a memory, but these houses, locations, friends also have, you know, memory, you know, with it. So if you go to a school, like, you know, for me, if I go back to my school, like elementary school, I see something like maybe a scar or something, you know, maybe scratch something that, you know, I did it in back in time, and I look at him like, oh, wow, you know. So it has a memory contained. But when things are damaged like this, things definitely change. And it's so interesting how photography was so cherished during this moment. Like, I saw a person picking up a photograph and hoping that is his daughter or his children. But if it's not, if it is, it's as important as his daughter. One photograph is as important as his daughter. But if it's not, it's just a piece of paper. So it's such huge difference. One single image means his daughter, but can be just a trash. So it's I saw this, you know, huge gap between one image. And this is a project also called Lost and Found. And these are the photographs saved from tsunami, and then these are the pictures that was put on the wall. And it really made me think about a lot about photography. Because at the end of the day, these family portraits or these memory, these snapshots are something that will not ever be considered as an art. So it's never is very important in art or photography world. But this is the foundation of our experience with photograph, right? I mean, our first experience is being shot by your parents, you know, when you are born, and then you're taking, always constantly taking picture of your family. So this is something very important, but we kind of take it as, you know, regard it, and we don't cherish it. So I it's really made me think of a lot of things. Now I'm going to show you one video, which is about 8 minutes, and the project that I did with Argentina photographer Alejandro Cheskelberg, other Alejandro from our fellow judges. Please take a look at the video, and I think I'll explain what it is. Alejandro is an Argentina photographer who uses large format camera and he takes photographs of a portrait of people, portrait of the people who live in the region during the nighttime using a flashlight. And I was actually curating his show in 2012 at one of the galleries that I was helping. And he came up to me and said, "Hiro, you know, I've been taking a photograph of people who are related with water." And he said, "I want to go up in the Tohoku and then you know, take a photograph of people there." And I said, "Hey, Alejandro, you know, I can't, you know, I, with all respect, I love your work, but you know, you cannot just go there and then take a photograph of people who are suffering still." So I said, okay, so there's one condition you can do this, is that, you know, I have my in-laws and relatives living in Otsuchi. So I go there with you, and then maybe we can do, we can think of something. We can think about a project with you and me. And it was a great moment for me as well, because as a creator or director of Dynasty, I mean, I didn't know what to do with what happened in Tohoku, but with the presence of this photographer from outside of Japan coming to Tohoku doing this project,
just please look at
I
the
found
camera.
A, I thought I found a way to somehow, you know, relate my work with Tohoku. When me and Alejandro went to Otsuchi, we did a lot of research. First, Alejandro did a research from Argentina. He googled Otsuchi or Tohoku, and he found a lot of people posting image of the place where their house used to be. So he kind of had a feeling that they wanted to leave, you know, they wanted to have a record of something that they have lost. And also when we went there, and starting talking with the residents or the locals there, there's this one man, one old man came up to us and said, look, you know, imagine a place, you know, you grew up in this town, and all of a sudden, very next day, your home is gone, your friend is gone, your photograph is gone. So everything that proved that I was there, I was living, has been just taken away. So he said he felt as if his life was denied. So that was like shocking to me. I was like, okay, so there is something that we have to do about that. And Alejandro and we decided to take a photograph of survivors on the place where they used to live to create a portrait of the family or the survivors. And he shot it with black and white film, because there's nothing left there, you know, just that one, the ruin, and nothing was left. So he shot with black and white and decided to use the color found in the lost photograph as if to connect the past memory into the present memory. So by doing so, he was kind of recovering the memory back from the past to the present. So it's, to me, is very important, because this is, you know, family portrait or family picture or the picture of a memory is very, very, you know, foundation of our experience of photography, like I said. And at the same time, in the history of Japanese photography, the coloring and the black and the white is something that we, you know, we use by the foreign photographers. So it's the technique that has been used in the past and bringing it back. So it's like from the beginning to now, it was just like kind of connected by a hundred work. And I think it's very important that it was done by not Japanese photographers, because if it was done by Japanese photographers, I think the local would not accept it. It's funny how it is. In Japan, if you are from the region, people would actually refuse to be taken photographed. But if you are from outside, people somehow welcome you. That's why a lot of people, like tourists, come to Japan and say, Japan's such a nice place, you know? Because we treat people from outside like kings and queens. But, you know, if you're from the region, it's kind of different. So this is the... You're just seeing the some of the images that Alejandro created. It's going to finish in a couple of seconds. But I think this project has been quite successful. We did a lot of exhibition, not only in Japan, but also in other countries. I think it travel 17 countries. The town of Otsuchi has only population of 10,000, and after the tsunami, it's only 8,000. So it's a very, very small fisherman's town, but it's known and remembered by many who had seen his work. So this is something that could, you know, that photography was used to evoke the memory of tsunami, but also to know about what happened. And I think this, when I show this work in Bogota, in Colombia, a lot of the people really liked, you know, I was surprised how many people actually was interested in the work. And I guess it's because, you know, this could happen to any of us. You know, we could get, I mean, I never thought when I was marrying my wife, I never thought my parents-in-law will, you know, be affected by tsunami. That's, I never thought about that. So I guess, you know, this is very universal. In that sense. So at last, we have a couple more minutes left, so what's next? So what do I do now, you know, after I did the Otsuchi project with Alejandro? This is what I do, you know, from museum to the public space. I organize a photography festival, so now I work internationally. I mean, we are talking about Japanese photography, but I mean, what is really Japanese photography? You know, if the photographer is Japanese, is that Japanese photography? You know, now today we're living in a world that is, I mean, connected. So, I mean, it's so hard to say what exactly is Japanese photography. I think there is no such things that we can define as photography as Japanese or American or Indian or whatever, European. I mean, yeah. So what I'm doing here is that I work as a collective, like I work with different people from different regions, and to organize something that only a team can do. And the T3 Photo Festival was had two curators, Miho and Federica. Those are both female. And exhibition design was done by architect Masatoshi Hirai, and under the theme called Invisible Stratum. And I think the photography is about seeing something we cannot see. You know, I think the photography is a way of seeing, but, you know, finding something we don't see it. A photographer can see it in a differently. So the theme Invisible Stratum is basically showing the typology of invisibility in the festival. Now when we were thinking about doing the festival, we picked this place called Ueno Park, and Ueno Park is where the first international expo took place back in Taisho era, so that's more than 100 years ago. And also it's a place 1923, there was an earthquake in Tokyo, and that's where people just kind of evacuated. So it's the place, the park. So the park itself has a lot of different layers of memories, but people actually don't know much about it. You know, we just see it as just a park, nice park. So when we designing an exhibition, we decided to pick a photographer that matches with the park. So for example, this is the work by a Japanese photographer, Masahiro Usami. This is an interesting work about Hiroshima. This is a completely staged, but this is not a photoshopped. So there are 300 actors and actresses, or the real people who lives and works in Hiroshima, gathered in front of the atomic bomb building. And another, the backdrop is real. So basically, he's visualizing the memory of the woman in the center. That's her. 75 years of her life, like what she have experienced through Hiroshima. So there is this atomic bomb, and this represents the people who were killed in the bomb. There is this the flowers. Basically, after that atomic bomb, it was said that there would be no plant is going to grow on this soil. But a year later, the plant decided, you know, came out. So this was the flower that first came out. There is also a famous baseball team called Hiroshima Cart that people loves in Hiroshima. So that's the character from there. And so much thing happened in 73 years. And this is the visualization of her experience in one photograph. So this is shot maybe 1/30 or 1/125th of seconds. But, you know, it talks about the 75 years of her memory, and at the same time, all the people who were involved with the, you know, and then all the time and then the hard work that the photographer did to get this one shot. So we actually exhibited it, his work in the entrance of the park like this. We also do international exhibitions, so we show the work of Salvatore Vitali, an Italian photographer. He's taken his series is about the passport security control in Switzerland, where it's the safest supposedly place in the world. But again, this is about, you know, security or the government power that is invisible. I mean, you can write it down in the world, but you cannot really see it. So he visualized that, and then what we did was we used the bamboo and collected each images. So when the wind blows, it shakes like tick. So, you know, it's funny. One thing is shaken, and then the entire thing is shaken. So it's not just showing the images, but, you know, the installation itself has some meaning as well. And this is a photograph image shot by Tomoko Yoneda. This is interesting piece because, as you can see, this is a glass, and it's a document. And this is a series called Between Visible and Invisible, and she wants to see what the historical figure was seeing. So literally, what she did was she picked up the glasses that was worn by like Gandhi or, you know, famous writers, and she takes a photograph of the writing that actually the person writes. So this was the supposedly what the historical figure was seeing. And this is how we exhibited it in the park. This was actually a photograph of called Luc Corbusier. It's the famous architect. And there is this National Western Museum in the park, which was built by Luc Corbusier. And then the Corbusier's artwork is kind of like seeing the building. So it is to kind of to understand, like, maybe the Le Corbusier was walking this park, maybe was sitting there, you know. So we're kind of creating this maybe happened memory inside a park. Like that. Also, we showed work by Taiyo Honorato and Nico Krebs. And this was something that reminded of the during the World War II. We had the zoo, and then we had to kill the elephant because the elephant was eating too much. So it kind of reminded me of this, you know, the ghost of the zoo. And also, Risaku Suzuki is called a reflection This is about seeing. You know, you see this beautiful image, most like reminds me of the Monet. But you know, when you're seeing, he questions you if you're seeing the surface of the water or maybe something else. So this is like when where is your focus is at. So he's like playing with the visual, and then how we exhibited it was under the water, like this in the fountain. So when you look at the image, you kind of question yourself: am I looking at the water or surface or in reflection? So it has the meaning. It matches with the image itself. This is also interesting work by Eva Stenram, and she talks about the male gaze. You know how we, in maybe Japan or Western culture, how we perceive things in male gaze. I guess you know how we want to see the female, but you know the artist blocks with the curtain and kind of tells us, hey, I know what you're trying to you know look for in us, but you know we are diffusing it. You know, it's very interesting work. And then we used it in like cotton in the middle of the house. So it's have some connection with the cotton and the banner. This is also interesting work by Maya Tami. This was exhibited in front of the National Science Museum. The work is called Male Milk and Female Milk. So it's like almost like it looks like a universe. But it's a microscopic image of the basically the milk, the female milk, and the semen. So, but you know, we cannot really tell what is what. So she's implying us, you know, we look different, but maybe in a biological sense, it's really hard to distinguish. This is work by Shinpei Takeda, and this is a cameraless photograph. He uses what do you call? Plate and buried under the soil of Fukushima, and what you are seeing, like this is also look beautiful like universe, but it's actually the reaction of the nuclear contamination basically in the soil. So it's interesting because this was shown like this in the box, and people go through each of the box and opening and see things, and then at first you will only see like a small pieces of the dots, and then people wonder what it is. And as you go farther and farther, you realize it's some you know it starts showing. And then behind the box, there is a number on it, and it's actually the distance, the kilometer by kilometer distance from the nuclear plant in Fukushima to where the photograph was shot. So if it gets closer and closer, you start seeing these reaction of the nuclear contamination. So that's something also invisible. We cannot see that. So this is the exhibition, and we also do a portfolio reviews. We review a lot of images for students for free, and trying to expose the work to international judges. And I guess the time is almost up, so I'd like to conclude this, that, you know, I talked about the history of Japanese photography in such a short time, and, you know, maybe I should have, as I kind of feel now, that I should have gone really, really deep on one time, one era, and shown a lot of images. But I think what I wanted to say at the end of the day is that, you know, we are all part of the history of photography, and what has been done by the past photographers always affects us, and then we have to build something upon it. And whether you notice or not, we cannot escape from the history, from the context. You know, you have to be aware of you know what you're doing, comparing or you know considering about the past history. And my hope, as the theme of the competition this year was hope, is that you know I wanna everybody you know my mission is that a lot of people look at the image and the people go, wow, I like it, it's beautiful, nice, you know, and but that's the end of it, and you know, and but I want like somebody to start talking about something that had never been done before. If you're not encountering the image, so this is one good example from the Ueno Park. You know, this father and his daughter is sitting in front of the picture, and she or he, I don't know what they talked about, but they were talking about image, and it's so interesting because whatever the conversation they were making had never happened if there was not this exhibition. So I guess that's the end of my talk, and then I'd like to thank you for listening till the very end. Thank you very much. So if you have any questions or whatever, I'd be happy to answer.
Thank you very much for your nice review of the history. And I would like to ask your opinion about the present behavior of photographers, like, you know, not professional one, but like normal people. When I been...
I can't really hear you.
I mean, I would like to ask you about the modern behavior of the people with the photography. Because for sure now the a lot of us here use their mobile phone, mm-hmm. but when I went in Japan, I saw some couples which are doing photograph by themselves, mm-hmm. with a normal camera tripod, and they like perfectly dressed. Mm-hmm. I don't know. This is some common behavior. So I'm just asking. It's not only connected with Japan, but in the world, because now it's like everyone doing a lot of mobile photography, but what you think? It will improve the quality, or still need to be the proper photographers? So, because you show in your history that nowadays a lot of girl photography, like maybe funny one done with mobiles, or still some behavior support. So, something about that. What do you feel? The behavior of the people, how it's affect nowadays the photography.
So if I get it correctly, so you came to my country, thank you very much, and then you saw a couple taking a photograph of themselves using the mobile phone?
No, they use a proper camera and tripod.
Okay.
Yeah. And I saw sometimes even the couple, they walk around, you know, like very serious.
Costume plate. Okay, so there is this obviously a huge, you know, fans of, you know, cosplay, like they want to be, you know, in it's called cosplay, I think.
Not like cosplay, but like the couple, I don't know, they like, if I would like to do my family photo, but they do like by themselves, you know, like stay together with their costumes, not funny costumes, but normal one.
Okay.
I don't know, is it something about Japan or...
I don't know it's how to answer that question. I have to say we love photography. I mean, hey, we produce a lot of camera brands, right? Like Sony to Canon, Nikon. So what can I say? I don't know. I mean, is that something? I don't know. I've never. That's a very hard question. I've been on, you know, maybe in other places like that happens.
I mean, it's like a very particular situation. I understand you, but I mean, what you're feeling? It's like everyone turned to mobile photography, or still a lot of people love to do photo with a proper camera, and how it's affect their photography now?
I don't know. It's just a new tool, you know. I mean, it's nice, and I think the best camera is something that you can always carry with you, because you can capture the moment. And I guess either iPhone or Samsung, whatever, the mobile camera is so handy. So I can't blame, you know, people shifting to the camera. I don't know if that's the answer that you were looking for. Yeah. But yeah, I guess mobile photography is definitely changing. I think everybody's taking a photograph. But I think before the panel, the judges, four judges was talking about, now it's about the project or portfolio or the stories, whatever. It's so hard. I mean, you can become very famous for one day or one night, or like, you know, Andy Warhol said, you know, whatever, with one single image, but it won't last, you know. It won't build your career. So if you want to become a professional, you have to stick with, you know, project the stories, and that takes time. And then, so I guess that's the answer for it. Thank you. And Alejandro?
Yeah. I just have one question regarding the project with Argentinian photographer, with Ale Chasky, about Tsuchi. You said that something that for me was very, very interesting, that was that those photos could have not been done by a Japanese photographer, only by a foreign photographer. And I just wonder why, more in depth, why you think so.
I think it's because one is true. I don't know. This is just my opinion, okay? But in Tohoku, there is this local religion or local worship that there's the gods comes from outside of their region every now and then, and then all the rituals, like all the monster looking, you know, ethnic kind of dances, those all comes only once in a year, with, you know, unique face and almost like monsters, and then I don't know why, but we, I think all the things, like we use kanji, for example, came from China, right? We use katakana, which is another way of writing, and that's only used to describe the word in English. So we accept things that come from outside of Japan so easily, like we absorb it and make it something better, maybe. You know, I mean, the car came from the Ford, and we create Toyota. Right, so maybe the idea of having something from outside and creating something new, or accepting something outsider, is a lot easier for us. I don't know why, but, you know, I think because the kinship or the local community is too strong. If somebody makes something, like if you, even though it's not your intention, if you make money out of something, you know, from the tragedy, people go like, "You are making money out of my, you know, our misery or whatever." But then from outsiders, I think it's okay. I think that's what I meant, yeah. Yep. So.
There is a specific tradition of photo book in Japan, because I really think that they are almost the best, maybe, making photo book.
Right.
So there is some specific region of some specific moment where photo books start really to have this power in Japan.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so. Like I said, in 1980s, there is the first photography museum, but until then, we didn't have the idea of collecting photographs, like storing or putting on the walls. So those ideas are all new. And before that, the output for the photographer was actually the photo book. So everybody wanted to make a photo book. So I think that's the difference. Like, for example, like Araki, whether you like it or not, he has like 400 different books already published. So that's quite insane. I mean, I know some great photographers who have published maybe 30, 40, 50 books. That's amazing. But, you know, they just I think that are the things that the Japanese photographer did in 1960s and 70s. They just made a lot of photo books. So that's where they developed their own way of telling the story, and also I think they developed their own language, I guess, you know, visual language or storytelling. Yeah. Oh.
I have a question. I have a question.
Sorry.
You can ask later on. I'll be around. Okay.
Looking at online photography these days, you think that a time when mainstream photography magazine will not be in existence anymore?
Sorry,
you know, these days you know, before you talked about contemporary photography, mm-hmm. yeah? And before the advent of internet, mm-hmm. there has been an existence of photography books, magazines, which you talked about, you were one of the editors. So my question is, looking at the way the world is going these days, digitally, you know.
What the Japanese photographer doing digitally?
Yeah, so you think there's a time, in general, around the world, I'm using the world as a case study. Do you think there's a point when people will not be able to produce book photography or mainstream photography, which comes up with the magazine photograph, which we can touch, which people can say, let me go and buy a copy, which will be in circulation? So do you think there's a time when these mainstream books, magazine will not be in existence, looking at the online digital world we're into today? Thank you.
I don't know if I heard you correctly, but you're talking about the effect of online photography?
Yeah, the effect of online and mainstream. So everybody's going digital now. Like, you can see everyone with their mobile phone.
Yeah,
you can see photography from Colombia as we are sitting here, from Argentina, from Japan.
Mm-hmm.
And meanwhile, one can be in Dubai and order for a copy of a photography book, and which will be shipped, or mm-hmm. which you can be, you know, sent all the way from Japan to here, where you have it in your hand. Do you think there's a time when the hard copy photography book or magazine will not be in existence, where people will shift to online? Yeah.
Oh, see, I honestly don't know, but you know, I mean, a lot of people said the film was dying, but the people still shoot with film, so the paper will probably last, you know, decades and then hundreds of years. So I don't think it's gonna the completely kill the medium, but yes, I have to say, because you know, if you look at the history of the image, that as the previous panel has talked about, it came from the cave, you know, then the paper, and then. It's just it's the image is the same. You know, we want to say something with the image, but the medium always differs, because you know, nowadays, like you said, back in time when I went, I came to Dubai, and I have my wife and kids back, you know, back in home, I will write them a letter, you know. But now today, I send them picture with a message, hey, or maybe even better with the movie, you know. So what we are doing is the same. Same thing from, you know, from the cave to today, but it's just the medium is different. So yes, I don't know how it's gonna change. I can't I'm not a prophet, so I cannot predict what's gonna happen. But I believe that the way of storytelling and everything's gonna change in 5 or 10 years. I mean, the medium of photography has changed so much in last 10 years, and I think what I see as Instagram is that a lot of Instagrammers or whatever who has a lot of followers is not necessarily the traditional photographers. Like Kawada Kikuji is a famous, I mean, in Japan he's a very famous photographer, and his book again sells for like $2,000-$3,000, you know, a very expensive book, but his followers like maybe 500 followers. So it's not like about how good his photograph is, you know, it doesn't match with the number of followers. So it's changing a lot, but I think the people will have to adjust to those changes, and if you cannot adjust to those changes, you know, it's just, it's too bad. It's not even about photography, but today I think it's so hard to live without adjusting yourself to the change. Okay, so thank you.
Yeah. So, hello. So it's just a technique.